The adventure continues, Radical Ones, with Sword and Sorcery Summer and 1963's classic Jason and the Argonauts.
I have found the finest crew in all Greece. Now for a ship that is worthy of them.
It's time to get radical.
Something really special that I've been promising to show you.
What would you do to get him?
Grab him! And take him! Take him! Like that!
Hey, look! Dungeons and Dragons ride!
Yes! Let this be our final battle!
I have my eyes, I have my cunning, and now I have strength.
A never-ending adventure, new for your Nintendo Entertainment System.
Zelda! You must find a champion. Heart, pure in spirit.
Champion? What champions?
Welcome to the podcast, everybody, to the Summer of Swords and Sorcery.
That was everyone's favorite brother, David, and it's me, Radical Ryan Hunter. Look at us changing it up this summer. The movie today, David, is Jason and the Argonauts from 1963. A matter of fact, it was released August 7th in 1963. And this is weird. The Wikipedia doesn't give, usually we'll say U.S., domestic. This says August 7th, 1963, New York.
Picture
so there
it.
You go. Yeah, picture it.
Heaven, New York. The lights, the crime.
The loincloth action.
Turn back, Jason. We're trapped.
Jason and the Argonauts. The classic story of an epic voyage that has been told and retold since the birth of Western civilization, now presented on the screen for the first time.
Pull! Pull! Do your hearts crack and your backs break?
Jason and his band of Argonauts, the mightiest warriors the world of adventure has ever known, in search of the fabulous magic Golden Fleece.
Where will you find this miracle?
I have heard there is a tree at the end of the world, with a fleece of gold hanging in its branches.
Here is the magnificent excitement of that legendary time when men like gods and gods like men lived and loved violently. Todd Armstrong and Nancy Kovac portray the classic lovers. Jason, the man who challenges the gods. Medea, who betrays a kingdom for love. Acastus, driven by a lust for power. Hera, goddess and woman, who defies the might of Zeus, king of the gods, who unleashes his fury at rebellious mortals. The Argonauts, caught in the clutches of the towering bronze giant Pelias. The Argonauts, battling vulturous harpies. Jason, threatened by the seven-headed Hydra. Medea, the temple dancer. Mysterious, exciting, and exotic. Jason, battling the army of skeletons.
Kill, kill, kill them all!
One man defying a universe of mortal and immortal dangers. Jason and the Argonauts. A search that became a legend.
After saving the life of his royal father's killer, Pelias, whom he fails to recognize, Jason is encouraged by the conniving murderer to begin a quest in search of the Golden Fleece. In doing so, Pelias hopes for Jason's death to thwart the prophecy that he will reclaim the throne, and along the journey, Jason is protected by the goddess Hera, and the crew includes Hercules, Acastus, and a saboteur planted by Pelias. I came about this movie as a kid. Well, I was young still. Must have been 8, 9 something, because there was a Sci-Fi Channel documentary about Ray Harryhausen, and anyone who listened to last week's episode about Clash of the Titans, this is the gentleman that brought us these classic stop motion mythical creatures in all these movies. And I remember seeing the skeleton scene in this movie. I was just so fascinated. Cut to years later, I ended up buying a used copy at Blockbuster. So ching ching, we're getting our retro topics in. This podcast is such a blessing, David, because there's movies like this that I really, really, really enjoyed. But there's times in life that you never get to watching certain movies. So the fact that this summer, or in general with our show, we're able to go back to these films and experience them is really such a joy.
I agree. If I could turn back time. This was really a good movie. I enjoyed it. And in the same vein as Clash of the Titans. So I really liked the differences, but also like the subtle nuances and everything that was not leftover material, but very similar. Very similar. And that mythical magic and sword and sorcery.
I don't want to give it away, but spoiler, this actually might be my favorite movie we've covered this summer.
That's because you like the actor. You thought he was hot. He had that Caesar cut.
One of the many reasons. I gotta say, though, didn't you think even down to the pacing, I never was bored. I felt like it went so quickly. A matter of fact, I'm like, wow, it's an hour and 40-something minutes, and it just went from boom to boom. There was never a time, even when it was calm for a moment, that I felt like, oh, this is dragging, or boom, boom, boom. It just kept you entertained.
I'd agree with that. I definitely thought it moved fairly quickly. I guess when we did Legend, do you remember us talking about kind of how it seemed chopped up, and we talked about it had many different versions and it kind of, you know, threw you all over the place.
We know about singing. We know
that we were watching totally different movies, but yet we did a solid podcast about it. So this definitely was paced right. It definitely went through everything. And I didn't feel like they had done a bad editing job on this one, obviously.
The only thing, and we're going to get into plot points, but I will say my one criticism is it kind of wraps up rather abruptly. We never get the satisfaction of him going back with the Golden Fleece to the kingdom. It literally just ends. Either they thought they were going to do like a Flash Gordon kind of serial with these movies, maybe. But it just ends. Like, I would have loved for him to go back to paleo diet.
Definite no-nos on today's paleo diet.
And throw the Golden Fleece at him or something like that. We don't get the satisfaction because he thinks he's dead at this point. Who would survive what these people went through, really, honestly?
Let's kind of go through. So this is very much like the Sword and the Sorcerer. You have a power-hungry king who is willing to be ruthless and kill other kings and destroy other kingdoms to gain power, wealth. You have that already, that character. And you always find in these movies, that is their fatal flaw. They don't know when to stop. Yes. Like, I've thought about this in my own life. How much is too much money and power? When you become a multi-billionaire, what really is the drive at that point when you can buy anything you want? Like, to me, I take my money and slip off to the back someplace.
Money, right? That's why millionaires always want more money.
Yeah, but you can't take it with you. So if you're secure and your family's secure, you secure your legacy, I think I would just buy myself that private island and live on it and have a great time. I don't know. But anyway, that's me. So that, I feel like that's the fatal flaw in a lot of these movies. It's actually a fatal flaw in a lot of leaders, even as of today. The power
hungry. Yeah.
And things like that. Acquiring. We're always trying to acquire things, but like I said, you can't take it with you. So anyway, I definitely have quite a few notes, as always.
Now, is this the age, David? The old Hollywood charm? But I'm getting very Ten Commandments with this. Even down to when Jason's mother put the baby on top of the Hera statue, and I kind of thought of the Pharaoh when he puts the dead son on top of the whatever the case is. It has this old Hollywood charm too, which I think works for it more than, let's just say, the Sword and the Sorcerer or something like that. You know, like, this has a charm.
You can definitely tell what era movies are from.
Yeah.
Most of the time, truly, because other than Metropolis, which was beyond its time in so many different ways, you definitely can tell when something's from a certain era. Yeah, I believe it does. It had that higher caliber and more actor. Are these actors more classically trained than, let's say, the actors in the 80s?
I think it's that. I think it's that they open always with these sweeping scores over a title screen. You know, love or hate old Hollywood movies, I feel like there's no way to get confused in movies like that. You know, they're kind of just, they give you everything kind of on the plate that you're not going, wait, why did they do that? Why did this happen? Why did that happen?
I mean, sometimes they are ridiculous, Ryan, though. Sometimes they are ridiculous. When I was watching this one movie, he's like, there's a woman in this room, and the guy's like, I just killed a man, and I'm gonna kill you. And you're like, oh my God. What do you say to that?
Well, before you do it, take me up. I don't know. So let's hit some of our notes. I mean, we got the main gist. Jason is this young man. He's on this quest for the Golden Fleece, which for some reason I didn't think in my head, and even though I've seen this a few times, it actually was a Golden Fleece sheep head that looked like tinsel, kind of, at some points. And
oh, I said it was a disco sheep. Tinsel.
That's how we start the quest. He's gathering his crew. Let's hit some notes, David.
So for me, this is very much in the vein of, let's say, Xena, because you have multitude of gods. I don't know if you agree with me. I actually think I liked the gods in this movie versus the Clash of the Titans. I felt like they were more stern, less indifferent to things, less indifferent. Like, they were vested in these humans. They were vested in what was going on. Like, all, even the gods in the background were like, when something was good was going on, they were like staring at their magic pool like Mumra, and like, you know what I mean? And they were really engaged with it. I felt like the gods in the Clash of the Titans were like, I'm so and bored petty. I don't care. And they were more petty. They still were vain. There was still vanity, of course, in the whole thing. I felt they were vain, some of them.
Didn't this Zeus, though, David, say something like to the fact that, well, if I got mad at every person who, you know, wronged, yeah, so even that sense, it's like, oh, wow, okay, Zeus is a little more relaxed in this movie. And he's not fathered anybody, as we know, as of yet.
No golden rain, or turn into a magical fox, or whatever he did to impregnate.
I'm actually currently editing Clash of the Titans, and when David mentions that he turns into a golden shower, I just lost it again listening to that. Or a wolf! That was great. So, Hera, I feel like she's known as a villain a lot of times in mythical things. And again, back to Hercules. Wasn't she kind of the one that was up against Hercules a lot of the time? Like, she was the villain because...
In Hercules, in Clash of the Titans, really, too. Yeah. She's kind of a crummy god.
Take a lever.
The whole thing with most of the mythical movies that I've seen with Hera or shows like Xena or Hercules is the fact that Hera is bitter because her husband Zeus is having sex with anything that has legs, basically.
But everywhere he went, he was tormented by his stepmother, Hera, the all-powerful queen of the gods. Hera's eternal obsession was to destroy Hercules, for he was the constant living reminder of Zeus's infidelity.
And golden rain and all the other
rains
stuff.
Rains on everybody.
Rain on me. I'll say it again. I said it in Clash of the Titans. I'll say it again. Ariana Grande.
In this movie, because Jason's mother called her name out 5 times.
Yet she didn't help her. So here's the thing. When Pelias was taking over and killing everybody, Jason's mother, the queen, took them to the temple to pray to Hera to protect her children, and she did nothing for them. So that's is where...
Eyes didn't open. She didn't look
honestly,
down.
If I was a god, I would be the god of, like, protection or something. Because if something was happening, I would smite down the evil people that were doing it. I feel like I'd have a sense of more morality. You know, like, when the Charm Ones became goddesses, how they could have lost their humanity, but they didn't. They pulled it together. That's how I would be.
The power is so intoxicating.
Who are you?
The Supremes.
It makes the world go bad.
Thank you, Bachelor Number 3.
What the hell is this? Goddesses gone wild?
I would be enjoying my magical powers, but I would be like, no, that's not right. You can't do that. And if someone's, like, especially being a parent, I guess, because if a child was being slaughtered, I would smite down the people that were going to kill a child.
So is it because Zeus gave her the allowance to do it? Because he asked her, how many times did the mother call upon you? And she said 5. And he's like, well, then you can help Jason 5 times in his quest. Which, actually, I kind of like that, because it makes you think of the genie genies. Do you waste a wish? Do you waste the help now? And you really have to kind of be
50-50 physical challenge.
Phone a friend.
I am Hera, queen of the gods, and your protector on this voyage. But my Lord Zeus has decreed a limit to the number of times I may help you when you call upon me. Do not speak now. I know what you must ask of me. Does the Golden Fleece exist? And if so, where is it?
That's two questions.
And I shall help him with only one answer. Search in the land of Colchis.
Then it does exist. But Colchis, that's the end of the world. No Greek has ever sailed there.
Now that you've heard that, are you so sure that you will not need my help?
I mean, there's points in this movie I'm like, Jason, do you really want to use it? And even her, she's like, don't waste it, Jason. This woman, her mast, her wooden head, is my favorite thing about this whole entire movie. I love her whispering continuously. I love that the boat creator was compelled to give her googly open eyes, and he doesn't know why.
And to face it towards the crew as opposed to away from the crew. I put, Ryan likes this because the Hera puppet has Muppet eyelashes.
She does! And the way that the eyes opened and the whispering, I was just charmed by the whole thing, David. And her with, well, then I must. Or whatever she says.
How many times did Aristo's daughter Briseis call upon you? By name?
Five.
Well, then you can help her brother five times. Five times only you can help him to overthrow Pelias. And that is my final word.
It will be 20 years before Jason becomes a man. Oh, an instant of time here on Mount Olympus. But a long 20 years for King Pelias. He cautiously travels the roads of Thessaly. Yes, Pelias, you have had years of watching and waiting for the man who must come to kill you. The man with one sand.
So it's 20 years for Jason, but a blink of the eye for the god. Jason is all grown up now. He goes to seek his rightful place in the throne. And the king is given this prophecy to watch out for the man with the one sandal. And if it was in our hometown when David and I were growing up, we would never know. We would have never known the difference.
One sandal.
So Jason saves this king. He brings him back to the kingdom. And this sets up that we said earlier, go find the Golden Fleece. He thinks he's never going to get it. Did he send his son? Is that the son?
He sent his son to sabotage and to basically maybe even retrieve the Golden Fleece at some point if they actually got to it. And he played this part where he was against the evil king Pelias, but it was him the whole time. And he basically came up with the concept of the Golden Fleece will bring peace and prosperity. And then that the king will be, I don't want to say subdued, but it would basically the people forced out by the people because they would be living in peace and prosperity and not despair and cruelty.
The son, I couldn't stand David. He was a brat. He annoyed the crap out of me. I know he's supposed to be this antagonist making the crew turn against Jason, but honestly, I would have threw him over the boat at various points of this movie because he was just a downer.
Having sailed this far together, I suppose we're free to speak our minds.
And what's on yours, Acastus?
We nose our way upstream. Rush the guards and seize the fleece. We'd be out into the open sea while Aetes and his Colchins were still asleep.
A night attack?
Yes.
And in the dark, during the attack, a man will die. That man will be me. A javelin in my back. A Greek javelin, Acastus. Maybe your javelin.
You'll die for that, Jason.
Keep back.
So another thing I wanted to say is we're talking about the ship, which gave me a very Viking sort of on the Nile vibe.
That was not a normal looking, I don't think, a Greek-Roman ship, right? It had eyes in the front. The masts look kind of Viking-like, yes.
So there's a point where Jason is taken to this like broken down temple area and he actually comes upon...
Burgess Meredith. No, no, I'm just joking.
Where he comes upon a broken statue of Hermes and he identifies it because this person is talking to him and it turns out it is Hermes and he's saying, why don't you believe in the gods?
Oh, he's the winged, I just thought of it. He's the winged messenger of Zeus.
Yeah.
Or something like that. From Xanadu, I remember.
So he, and there's no Olivia Newton-John in this movie.
No, there isn't.
he brings him to the gods. He shrinks him, or he's small compared to the gods.
Yes, I guess that's what it's supposed to
be. And the gods almost like they're amused by him. Zeus is like, "You're going to need a ship. You're going to need that." And Jason is very proud or prideful, or has had to survive on his own. So he's like, "I don't need help getting a ship." He's like, "Are you sure? Because this is in treacherous water." And he's like, "I guess you don't want the help of the gods." And then it's this like kind of like playful banter back and forth. You knew Zeus knew what he was going to do from the beginning.
Right.
There was this playfulness, and then finally, you know, they get down to brass tacks and what's going to happen, what needs to be done. I guess Hera, in the form of that shipmaster speaking to him and granting him knowledge or wishes or whatever you want to say, was kind of like his gift from the gods, like in Clash of the Titans.
Exactly.
You know, the helmet and all of that stuff. So
this is where, I mean, we passed this part already, but when Hera jumps out on the king, like I wrote, like in Dora and Bewitched, she comes out of smoke and just scares him to fall off the horse and just smokes out. I was like, oh yes, this woman, fabulous.
But now, is that the setup? Did they
purpose? Yes, she's setting the, yes, they're setting the motions, because he fell in the water for Jason to rescue him. Exactly.
Now you see that the gods play a role in molding and manipulating human lives.
Perfectly said, David. So he needs to get a ship now, right, on his own, that will be able to journey across the world, basically. The older gentleman, he's kind of like, I mean, I'm going to invoke this man's name again. He's the Burgess Meredith character. In a way, he's an older gentleman. He's kind of always on Jason's side, giving him a little bit of knowledge. And he needs to hire a crew, right, of warriors, because he said, I can get them too. He told Zeus. So yes, you're right. He's very self-sufficient. He kind of like puts on the Olympic Games, David.
Oh my God, that's exactly what I said. I said, where did I write my note? Jason created the first Olympics.
I mean, that's what it seems like, right? Arrows, archery, discus throws. And they're like, this one can do this. And then Hercules.
I mean to sail with you, Jason. Tell me which champion you want me to beat.
No one. I know you can beat us all. Your place is reserved.
Hercules. Yes. Hercules?
Yes?
My name is Hylas. Like you, I came too late to compete in the games. But it occurs to me that if I can beat you at something, Jason couldn't refuse me a place in his ship either. After all, he might need brains as well as brawn. Shall we compete?
Discus?
Now, this is not your typical Hercules, I would say. I've never seen such a... I would call him kind of jolly at first, right? Jolly.
Busted. Place.
Did you say busted?
I said Hercules. It's like, do you remember in... Into the,
I said busted. Oh, do you remember God.
The Spider-Man movie Into the Multiverse where the altar, Peter Parker's, and Aunt May goes, you look tired, Peter.
This is Hercules.
That's what I say. But no offense to the actor, because he wasn't a bad looking man, but he
was like a, what would you call,
trimmed up the beard a little bit. It looked like he had a little too much to drink at times. He was living it up. He was full of himself.
He was a bear, right? He was like a bear Hercules. He was hairy. I've never seen a hairy Hercules. Well, but that's just part of this movie.
Times at like bars.
Oh my God. And then I wrote, the one who comes, the smaller kind of scholar, I was rooting for them the whole time. I was like, this is a love affair that's gonna happen. Hercules and that one that he kind of like, didn't he pick him up even after he bested him in the discus throw? He put him over his shoulder or something.
You shall have your place, Hylas.
Hail, Hylas!
I have found the finest crew in all Greece.
And
I was rooting for you. We were all rooting for you.
But then I do love this, because later on, I mean, when we get to the island, we'll talk about it, but he stayed for his man. He stayed for his man.
Stand by your man and show the world you love him.
So we get on the boat. Many things that happen. Many, many things. And these men are thirsty. They're
hungry. Their hands are all blistered and...
I thought you were going to say they're tanned. They got all tanned. And he constantly, Jason, you know, he's standing in front of the Hera statue, like we mentioned. One of his second or third? Because I think she said already, like, I already helped you twice, so we're already counting down as it goes. So the next thing is they're starving. So she says, there is an island. You will have all the food and drink you want, but do not take anything. This island was basically like an armory or something for the gods, where they forged weapons of some kind. This is where these gigantic brass titans, I suppose, are residing. So we get to the island, David, and he says, you know, have all the food and drink you want, but take nothing. And then Hercules and smaller gentlemen go on a quest, and they come across the gigantic statue of Talos and many other ones, David, but they just so happen to see that he's perched upon something that looks like, I guess you would say, the Statue of Liberty. There's a base with a door in it.
That's exactly what I was thinking.
They open the door and they see treasure room of the gods, including pearls and a gigantic hair clip of some kind.
Yeah, I don't know. So basically, Hercules takes something from underneath this statue, this treasure room.
He said he'll use it as a javelin? A javelin or something.
He'll use it as a weapon. He'll use it as a weapon.
Because, David, everything is a weapon, David. Even a hairpin.
Well, that is true. Everything is a weapon, but I don't know why he thinks he needed that weapon to begin with. Didn't he bring something of his own?
But he had his own strength, because, right, the door creepily closes. Not that
and
that's a word.
And he pushes it open. Well, he's Hercules.
But he goes, like, he kind of, like, has to, like, pump himself up.
He has to summon it. He's got to summon the power. I've summoned the power more than once.
David has summoned the power with those legs. So he kind of opens the door. I love it. And he goes, the wind must have blew it. And I'm like, oh, Hercules, you just had to use your powers. I don't think the wind blew that gigantic door. But this is amazing. Talos, when he looks over, I found out that people who watched this movie when they were kids are traumatized when Talos' head turned. Were you taken by the head turning, looking at them? Yeah.
It was creepy for sure.
That's not a Wheeler, though, from the Return to Oz. So this activates Talos coming to life, and then Hercules and his gentleman friend start running, but he's still holding the hairpin.
Do you think that if he would have returned it when he just saw the creature, that it would have stopped? Or once you touch it? Was this like Abu in Aladdin? Once he touched the gem,
it's over. He took it out on the whole crew, basically, after that, right?
And no remorse as far as... So this thing is going around following, killing, whatever he can get at. They're running around trying to escape it. And then you have Jason, who goes over to the statue
of Hera
and asks, and she's like, use your brain, not your brawn, basically.
Yeah, she says, think before you waste the gift of the gods. And he goes, I repeat that question. And this is where she goes, well, then I must answer. And she tells him, look to his foot. So I was like, oh, Achilles' heel?
Yeah.
But it almost turned out to be like this was a mechanical acid flew out or lava or something out of like a plug. It was very strange.
Medusa blood,
much like that. So there's a part right before this happens that they're getting chased. Hercules drops the weapon, and for some reason, the guy goes back, oh, Hercules, you dropped your thing. This is why I thought he wanted to impress him. And he ends up getting crushed.
Yeah.
So Jason says, you disobeyed me. He says, you have till nightfall. And we'll sail off then. He goes, leave whenever you want to, Hercules says, because I am not leaving this guy. So, of course, the crew isn't going to go because Mr. Daddy's boy is getting them all riled up. So Jason has to, again, use another wish, right? And have Hera, the mast, open those beautiful wooden eyes of hers. And she says Hercules' journey is like meant to be elsewhere, basically. So I don't know how the hell he's going to get off this island.
Survivor, get off the island.
They have to repair this boat, which I don't know how they did it, how they got the tools, but they repaired this boat. The next thing we get to is they have to find out information from this blind man who's being
tormented,
held captive by harpies.
By harpies.
Well, I was going to say, David, I mean, I know the first appearance of a harpy is Hunger, the harpy from She-Ra, that I think of automatically.
Hunger's throne room should be right behind these doors.
Then let's go and say hello.
Look, that must be Queen Angela. Come on.
Queen Angela, we are here to free you.
How nice of you!
But are they always kind of like this? They keep people starved? This seems to be their deal. They starve people and then eat in front of them?
Maybe one influenced the other. Maybe that just was a creative decision.
Okay, that makes sense.
Harpies are almost like vultures in a way, too.
It's not the harpy from Last Unicorn, though, that looks like a bird with some breastises.
It's a killer. They're all killers, though.
The harpy!
So you find that this man is cursed with blindness by Zeus because he dared to challenge him or say something he didn't like.
The gods have ordered me to tell you whatever you want to know, but the gods have gone too far with me. They can punish a man so much, and then one day he abandons them. He says, "All right, Zeus, throw a thunderbolt. Let the earth swallow me. I defy you." You growl away all you like, Zeus. I mean what I say. Jason, I'll tell you what you want to know, only if you'll meet my price.
What is your price, then?
Free me from these tormenting harpies.
If Zeus sent those creatures to plague him, we'd be unwise to interfere.
That's my price.
Then we'll meet it, Phineas. We'll make you the master of the harpies.
It's never explained. These women bring him food at the table, and as soon as the food comes, the harpies come down to taunt him and grab the food and eat it for themselves.
Yeah, they run away, right? These women, they just throw the food down and they're like, oh, hell no. So they promise that they're gonna capture these harpies, which are, of course, stop motion again. They flutter around.
Blue devils, I was calling them.
They were blue, right? They were blue. They trap them in a net, and then they end up putting them in a cage. So now, the blind man can eat all he wants, and he kind of just throws them scraps, and they fight over it. God.
So, I had told you earlier, off camera, that I would have slashed their wings. They can't fly anymore, because what happens if that cage gets opened?
Oh, they're screwed. They'll probably kill them this time. Eat them.
They were trapped under this big netting they had put over.
That I didn't get either, because I thought they could rip the net open, but...
However it works, it works. They put them in cages. So I would have, when they were on the ground, I would have slashed their wings so they cannot fly anymore. That would have been the smartest thing. They're vicious and evil. They're like blue flying devils. So they have no redeeming qualities. Not like they're doing it to survive. They're doing it to torment people, and they're evil. So I would have done the same thing. In case they got out, they can only walk. And they don't seem to be very agile with walking if they're not flying. So I'm just saying that's a personal thing for me. Like, you know, that
it seems like personally, I would maim their wings.
I would maim their wings so they can never fly again. Just like I told you, I would have chopped Mumra's head off when I had the chance, when they all had him help, you know, had
held
him down.
Hogtied and held him down with their hands. Yeah. Is this the island where Medea, the love interest, is on, David?
So first of all, I didn't know Tyler Perry was around then.
Hey everybody, Tyler Perry here, and my new trailer for my movie. Tyler Perry's a Medea
Clash of the Titans.
You get to see it right here. You don't have to wait too long to see this one.
Hey, check it out, y'all. Check it out. Hallelujah.
I was waiting for Medea to show up. But the Medea we got was, I call her generic beautiful brunette woman. And fun fact, David, I don't know if you noticed, out of the whole cast, Jason and Medea, the two leads, I guess, although she comes much later, were both redubbed. So those were not their voices. Our Todd Armstrong as Jason was American and everyone else was English. So they said his American accent would take away from everyone else's. And it actually turned out this ruined him in Hollywood, because I guess he got a stigma because they thought they had to redub his voice, and it affected the rest of his career. So his voice is dubbed, and so is Medea. I've always been able to notice this. I don't know, it's because I watch sub Sailor Moon, but I can always tell when voices are off on people. Anyway, it's just neither here nor there, but I just thought it was a fun fact. So we come across Medea, and she says, you know, come back to my island. Is this where she's...
There is
a part where they have to go through this treacherous stretch.
Oh, you're right, David. That's before Medea. I see it's right here. Yes, the guy, the blind guy, tells them they have to reach Colchias by sailing between the crashing rocks. And he gives Jason an amulet of the sea god Triton. What did you think about that? I thought it looked actually fabulous.
I thought it looked really good. I think it was great. I don't think there was anything I could say negative, especially considering the era that it was made.
He had
I didn't
a
see
tail.
Carrie out her sisters with King Triton coming out.
No, and he was giant as well. He kind of didn't look too happy, though, did he? He looks at them kind of like, Oh, you're right, David, because he destroyed Medea's ship, and she was along the rubble with two other people that they saved. Yeah, yeah, that's right. And she said, thank you for saving me. Come to my island.
Come to my window.
Your ship was lost. We found only two other survivors. They're being looked after. When did you sail from Colchis?
Dawn this morning.
Dawn? Then our journey is nearly over.
Where have you come from?
Thessaly.
But that's the other side of the world. You don't look like a merchant. Your vessel's a fighting ship.
We'd be foolish to sail unarmed. By all accounts, your king, Aetes, fears the gods. And we were sent by the gods. But I'm going to talk to him alone, peacefully. Now you answer a question. What was your ship doing in such dangerous waters?
We came to sacrifice to the gods of the rocks. To throw flowers onto the sea to make it safe for our ships. I'm afraid our gods were angry, not so powerful as yours.
Are you a priestess?
I serve in the temple of Hecate.
A dancer? Is Hecate the god of the Colchians?
The goddess.
But I'd heard they worship some strange idol. The skull and skin of a ram.
No ordinary ram. Its fleece is of gold. A gift of the gods themselves, and it's brought our city great peace and prosperity.
We'll put you ashore at dawn tomorrow. Perhaps you will show me the way to the city. Now, tell me your name.
Medea. And you can answer my first question. Who are you?
My name is Jason.
Oh, she's a high priestess, by the way. The high priestess of Colchia.
So let me just tell you something. I put down crazy-ass temple dancing.
What was that?
Very 60s.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, it was a very 60s-infused dancing thing around this statue with three heads. It was like a cat gods. It looked like it could have been in Mumra's pyramid, really.
Honestly, you're right, David. And that was the... Actually, I don't remember, but he said it was some kind of god of the underworld, I thought, or something like that.
Like, yeah, they took it... Like, so the gods of Olympus are not necessarily nice, but they're not full-on demonic. They worship a, like, literally dark, evil creature thing.
It's actually described as a cult, it says.
You know,
so I guess it's a cult, but to me that doesn't make any sense because everyone in this generation worship different random gods, right? So how is it a cult?
I also put a note, whose gods are more powerful?
Clash of the Titans.
So, and the other thing is, when did Jason slap a bitch with a net?
Yes, this is when they're kind of rising up against him. The guy, the son, right? The son of...
Yeah.
He got his sword knocked out of his hand. Yeah, and he uses a net.
Jason hits that. She slaps him like, I'm sorry I have to do this to you, Susan. From Blank Man.
So when they're there, they accept the invitation from the king there. Unknown to them, Acastus has warned the king of Jason's quest for the Golden Fleece.
Yes, so you find out that he does drop a dime on Jason, and the king knows what his intentions are. He captures everybody.
In the most dramatic way, David. They're in the middle of Eden, and all of a sudden he decides to go, I know why you're here.
I know what you did last summer.
I know what you did last summer. But the high priestess isn't involved in this. She doesn't know.
She's already smitten with Jason because he rescued her.
She's in love, David. She says, I'm in love with you. This is the same day.
Mama, I'm in love with the criminal. Britney Spears.
That is exactly right. So he imprisons the Argonauts. I forgot to tell our beautiful radical ones. I guess his crew is called the Argonauts. That's where you get Jason and the Argonauts. Jason is imprisoned elsewhere, but she lets him out, right? She sneaks away. And then somehow, I guess everyone's passed out from the food and the wine. And she walks past the guards, but she brings all these men out. I was like, oh, damn you, Madea. That's great. She just walks right past these people.
Tyler Perry's Madea goes to jail.
Okay, so then the island has the fleece. And this is what we were saying, David. I was not prepared for the ram's head with the tinsel. It looked like a gigantic fleece. Like, is that really what one large sheep would produce?
I guess. I mean, it had to look magical and sparkly to really be anything, really. So you think about that one.
Right in front of them, David, it turns to dirt looking. Like, it's the shine
well, when
stops.
They touch it, when they touch it. I mean, they take it from its perch. Medea helps them escape. They end up getting to the area with the fleece. The king is awakened from his drunken slumber, I guess, partying. Like, it's 1999. And then he orders everybody to, let's go. Let's go. We're going to kill these guys. And they head towards the fleece.
Instead of the Kraken, we release the Hydra, which is a famous multi-headed dragon beast.
Serpent creature. It's the Dungeons and Dragons ride.
I was going to say, David had growing up, which I ended up rebuying, the Dungeons and Dragons, what would you call it? Hydra. I think it is the Hydra, the rubber
you
monster.
You rebought it? Well, it's mine. I'm going to go through all your boxes that you have stored in my house. That is my Hydra.
It's there somewhere. It's there somewhere.
I already accosted your sort of omens to show off to people to get more listeners.
I want you to protect it, David. That's fine with me. Protect it. The Hydra is out. This is the part where I'm saying, because like even the sentence for the rest of the movie is like a sentence left. The Hydra battle happens pretty quickly.
Get the fleece.
Medea is mortally wounded by an arrow, but Jason heals her with the fleece. They lay her down. They throw the fleece over her. Woman came back to life. She barely looked like she was alive to begin with, this woman, this actress.
And Pelias' son is killed or severely injured by the Hydra. It's like crushed in its like tail.
Thank God. No, I really didn't enjoy him. So, after this happens, Atius, I believe is the king's name, asked his people, gather those Hydra teeth for me. Because the word he used to describe these teeth were something about the children of darkness, the children of the Hydra's teeth. There is no protection. And it's the victims of the Hydra rise from the grave. And I wrote, rise from your grave, which is a famous quote from the Sega game, Altered Beast. They have Zeus in the beginning and into the voiceover.
Rise from your grave.
Rise from your grave.
I remember that.
We played it on one of those Sega reissue things. So David, how are they the children of the Hydra?
Rise up, you dead, slain of the Hydra. Rise from your graves and avenge us. Those who steal the Golden Fleece must die.
It's the teeth, but it's their victims that come out of the ground.
They are the children of the night, brought to light.
Last unicorn again. So these are its children, the victims somehow. Did you hear them at first? And again, classic stop motion animation. This is the scene that most people know about, the skeleton battle. They kind of do a Xena scream for a minute, the skeletons. They make a sound like Xena, much like you did last week. They kind of do the Xena call and they rush to these Argonauts.
I wrote this down. The king goes, kill, 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 kill them all, kill.
And I gotta tell you, he makes a more impact in this movie than the actual villain.
So Jason ends up killing the Hydra, right? Then he has the men, before he gets the teeth, he actually does some kind of calls on some powder to burn up the Hydra's skin off so it becomes just bone.
Yeah.
So he too, which is very dark. It's very dark. And the fact that she's a priestess of this darkness, I'm being honest, it was a turnoff. I'm used to my princesses and everything being a little more pure and wholesome.
It's the fact that they made her a priestess. Actually, it would have been a little more maybe exciting to give her a little power kind of thing, you know, like her to able to aid. But this is what I mean. It just wraps up. They fight the skeleton warriors, children of the Hydra's teeth, in parentheses, emerge from the ground. Jason and his team hold them off while Medea and Argus escape back to the Argo with the fleece. The Argo is their ship. We didn't mention that. So after the prolonged battle in which his companions are killed, Jason escapes by quickly jumping into the sea. Jason, Medea, and the surviving Argonauts begin their voyage home, and on Olympus, Zeus tells Hera they are not done with Jason. That's the thing. I would have loved more of a wrap-up, but maybe it would have stretched on too long if they had to go then sail back through everything they did to get to the king originally with the fleece. Or, like we said, a sequel, possibly, they might have thought.
Absolutely. You know, the thing is that the king, whether he was evil or not, was justified in protecting the fleece because it brought them prosperity, I guess, and why would someone came to their kingdom. So I wasn't really mad at him for that. I just didn't like the whole weird, I don't know, it was just a little
strange. Jebel priest Mamra.
Yeah, it was like...
This actually says there's differences from the actual mythology, because Jason and the Argonauts is one of the earliest tales. The word name Jason, to me, I don't know how that's a Greek name, but it must have been something else. It must have sounded different.
Gesonit.
Ooh. The film ultimately omits the story of Medea killing and butchering her own brother to help Jason and the Argonauts escape.
Well, there's a part with Medea that says, I no longer have a country. I no longer have a... Like, she's giving up everything for him.
Well, she already says, I love you. So after that, where else can you go? She's like, take me with you, Jason. Take me with you.
She was wrapped in gold.
She literally was.
Glitter and gold, Ryan. Like, gem.
If you were her, would you have just sailed with that fleece around? Oh, Jason, let me protect this fleece. Let me wear this fleece upon me. You know it's cold on this damn ship at night.
I wonder if she could just snip a couple of pieces off of it and put it in a locket or something.
You know, because you know these, you know, somehow the gods would find out. They would ruin the fleece. They would set it afire. They would turn it into a creature.
My thoughts are, I like the movie. I know that you liked two big parts, Jason and the Muppet eyelash Hera mask.
I would love to have a little Hera to put in the car like that with the eyes that opened up. Like a little, and the eyes bounce as you go, almost like a bobble.
Like a hula girl?
Like a hula girl, something but bobbles up and down.
And then it whispers, I have a secret.
A GPS, David! Oh my god! You're going the wrong way, Jason. But don't waste my coordinates. Jason, yes, what a handsome actor. Too bad his career didn't go anywhere after this movie. But I thought he was a very charismatic lead. I thought the story, again, A Clash of the Titans will always be a classic. It will be gorgeous. It's beautifully done. Boo-boo, Bobo, Boopy, the owl. I love that creature. But there's something about Jason, and take him out of the story. Again, I think it's just such great storytelling. Fast, no downtime, no boringness, self-explanatory. You could watch this, I feel like, quickly on a Saturday, a Sunday, a night, you know, like, it's an easy watch. Matter of fact, it's free right now on Crackle, David.
Nothing is for free, Ryan.
No, tell him.
You want to see the same Gain, Downey, and Tide commercials over and over again every 4 or 5 minutes, then you watch it on Crackle. Spend the money. Rent it.
I would buy it if you're a physical media person, because it's so cheap. Mine was used on Blockbuster, like I said, but they did a remake, David, in 2000. Unfortunately, we have to crank out these movies, Radical Ones, because I wanted to watch more of the remake. I kind of skimmed it. Also available on Crackle and Tubi. So clearly this movie didn't go nowhere. It's like a 3-hour made-for-TV miniseries that they aired, and I would like to see what they did. I mean, maybe in the future.
Ryan, don't insult Tubi and Crackle. What if they want to be a sponsor?
Well then, Tubi, you are the best thing we've ever had. You give us so much. Crackle, we love Gain laundry detergent.
Apparently you do too, Crackle.
I got Burger King. Anytime I got a commercial, it was Burger King. Maybe it's location. Like, I notice even our ad on Red Circle now, I think, changed by location. So we never know what the hell they are. I've heard everyone down to speech therapy, which, by the way, are they trying to tell us something, David?
Perhaps.
They're like, let's not insult them, but, you know, put that speech therapy commercial in there somehow.
I want you to know that I am friends with one of my friends is a speech pathologist, and there's nothing wrong with the way I speak. I didn't have her listen to you, though.
No, well, you're not the problem, David. Ryan is the one. You know, our lovely Leah, one of our radical ones, she always says she gets a kick out of my, what does David used to call them, Ryanisms?
I started a list of that, I remember, and then I don't know what I did with it. Maybe it's in the recesses of my phone someplace.
Ryanisms, where I confuse things, call things every other word that it's supposed to be. This is nothing new, but...
I do it too. Sometimes I, like, listen back from the podcast once you've put it out, and I'm like, wait a minute. Do I really think that word means that? Or did I just say that wrong? I catch myself too, but yours is just more pronounced and easy to pick out.
Well, we never said that we were Oscar award winning.
We are.
During our Sword and Sorcery summer, I mean, my God, I feel like it's just begun. We've actually filmed a few, David and I, ahead of time, because my poor brother's going to be very busy shortly. We're trying to get things ahead, so I can't wait for us to get further along. We figured out our last episode before we go and break in September. And you radical ones, you know our breaks aren't that long. We're already back by the end of September, much to my dismay, because I feel like I could never catch up for us, is going to be Conan the Destroyer. We would skip the first movie and go to the Grace Jones one.
Grace Jones.
And David's favorite scene ever, of course, is the grab 'em
and take 'em.
Yeah, she says it just like that. Take 'em, like it's a question almost. Take 'em. We will end the summer with that, but in between, my God, we're even doing Return to Oz for the magical situation. That's going to be a threesome with Rob again. And let's just say, if we happen to end this summer, then nothing's going to stop us from doing more along the while, you know, even horror movies. I'm almost thinking about doing Return of the Living Dead summer eventually, because, David, we have so many more zombie movies, too. There's only so many movies we can cover in a summer, unfortunately.
That's true. Maybe we should do a poll and see what people are really interested in.
There's so much, I mean, Sword and Sorcery movie. There is everything. Even like David said, even down to Dungeons & Dragons cartoon, like Thundar the Barbarian, which we'll probably just do an episode eventually anyway, David and I, about the series. But we could have did that, you know, like...
And Princess Ariel.
The original Ariel. That's right. Any parting words before we sign off for this week?
No, I think that... The work speaks for itself, Ryan. The work speaks for itself. It's very deep. It's so deep. Maybe we should do a summer of vampires.
The summer of sucking?
Oh my God.
Summer sucks.
I want people to say, it's just feeling like, if you knew, if you watch this podcast, it does say that it sucks.
Dryness, unprofessionalism, can't speak, two thumbs way, way down. With that said, Radical Ones, you can always find the lovely Brother David at Universal Appeal 2020, all one word. The Radical Retro Rewind Podcast, one word, on Instagram, TikTok, YouTube, and more. Goodbye, everybody.
Bye. Stay.